Okay, this is now. This is now live. That's right.
It looks okay with the lights full here. Because otherwise, someone should really bring the lights up and down for me if you have lights up all the way.
I can read that on the screen. Going. Three people are watching you, including me. So two other people are watching you.
Pep band plays tonight, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do they have a certain time that
they're heading over there now?
Okay, so they shouldn't be coming in during.
I don't know. I have to look in. I see a seat in the spot. It's like pretty, and it's two. one to ask.
He asked me to ask a question.
That was one to ask.
You can tell
me. Are you just going to torture us until we figure it out?
He's going to torture me until I figure it out. He's going to dog point slowly on the lesson.
Text it to me.
I'll text
it. Okay.
Oh,
yes.
Maybe a couple, just what you want to do.
It's like, okay.
We're good?
Yeah.
All right. Will hear
know about the trumpet? What is probably the most distinct characteristic of the trumpet? Probably valve, right? Everybody knows, non-musicians also. Flared bell, higher range, different styles, different genres of music. Trumpet evolution is pretty complicated. I did not know this until I really started to research it. I thought I had a good understanding, I did not, until I started to research for this presentation. The family tree is quite extensive compared to instruments like the piano, violin, or even the flute. The lifespan is pretty short compared to those instruments, and the changes, pretty intense. Before the Baroque, the earliest versions of a trumpet, animal horns, and there was no musical anything about these instruments whatsoever. This was practical. It was alerting in battle, signaling a meeting in the community, or ceremonies, things of that nature. No musical capabilities at all. Obviously, there are some notable changes from ancient Greece to the Baroque, but for the sake of time, we'd be here for days. I'm not going to quite get into that, but you can hear that in the other presentation. So for the sake of time, I'm going to jump into the Baroque, where, you guessed it, the natural trumpet was the predominant instrument of the time period. You probably noticed, it doesn't have valves. They're not there. They were simply lengths of metal tubing folded over X number of times. They did have a flared bell. The standard key of the time period was D. That's why, you know, especially trumpet players, we see a lot of people with trumpet music in D. Because if they wanted a new key, they had to insert crooks or make a new horn. Got pretty difficult. Again, we have no vowels, which means the players rely on our embouchures. Now, we still do that. However, the horn helps us out so much. The vowels help us out so much. And this is on every brass instrument. Every brass instrument is based on the harmonic series, which, as I'm sure you all know from theory, is the spectrum of notes in which you can play without depressing any vowels, or same concept by pressing down vowel combination. The thing about the trumpet is, or brass instruments as a whole, excuse me, as you get higher in the harmonic series, the partials get smaller, which is essentially why most Baroque music we play on piccolo trumpet. That's why the range is so high, because you have a lot more access to notes up there. That's also why the fanfare is so stereotypical for the trumpet, because that's what we used to only be able to do. That's why it took a pretty long time for trumpets to actually become what you would call a virtuosic instrument. All right. The classical era, our first significant change, essentially. This is a key trumpet. This was pretty much the conversation started to vowels for the trumpet. And we see this happening with the Haydn Trumpet Concerto in E flat with Haydn and Anton Weidinger. This was premiered in 1800. So really, before then, we had no way of playing chromatically. So chromaticism in the lower register was essentially what we were going for. Before then, like I said, everything is in the upper register. And this is the most significant change in trumpet innovation. This change, like I said, eventually leads to vowels, and this opened the door to new, more virtuosic capabilities for the instrument and its players. So players started to get better because we now have better equipment. I didn't know this at first, but it wasn't exactly initially welcome. People were more so drawn to the more noble sound of a natural trumpet. You know, it sounds like royalty. And now cutting holes in the tubing to now play the lower register, people really didn't like that. And I never thought about it that way until I came across. design started to change and the wind band started to become very popular in America, especially, cornets were the instruments that were used. And even though we can play the same music, it's not a trumpet. Don't let anybody tell you otherwise. Again, the cornet leads us to the modern B-flat trumpet eventually. That's what we use now. And so eventually the cornet became phased out and the trumpet took its spot. Now some people still play cornets. I actually had a friend growing up that couldn't hold a big trumpet, so she used the cornet. So now I'm a trumpet player, by the way. It didn't hinder her at all, but we always kind of joke at her about that. But there's so much more I could talk about. And then one last thing. We wanted to sort of be able to revisit Baroque music, which is why the piccolo trumpet was essentially created. Because how, that question says it all right there, how again do we play the great works of Handel and Bach? Alright. So now we're going to get into what we came here to talk about. 20th century performance techniques. Moving into that, these are some of the trumpet and other brass instruments specific 20th century techniques. Fall, flutter tongues, which I do still have problems with that, by the way. Glissando, growl, vowel manipulations, pedal tones, pitch bending, you can do that by vowel manipulations or from the embouchure, shakes, mutes, and many, many more. And the thing about these is the great capabilities that 20th century music does for us as musicians and for our instruments, it really tests our extreme capabilities, the 100 and the zeros, and sometimes changing between them just like that. And that's what really kind of sets apart 20th century music from a lot of our normal day-to-day rep. Not that that's not good, sophisticated rep that we, you know, enjoy playing, it's just 20th century music really tests you in a way mentally and physically that a lot of people really don't get until you're in the middle of it. So those are some specific techniques. Challenges of unaccompanied work. So I touched on that a little bit in the intro, but now we're going to get into that. So contemporary unaccompanied music is not at all frivolous. I used to think that. There is more artistic guidance than accompanied music. For example, if I were to play the Haydn Concerto, you know, there are a few performer notes and composer notes along the way. However, what's on the page is pretty much what we're going to play. Now, with 20th century music, composers can write performance notes. I want you to play this. I want you to play that. Do not do this. Make sense? I can't take credit for what I'm about to say. This is all Professor Yao on this one. And I thought, there must be enough artistic independence and maturity from the performer to meld the composer's intention and the artist's creativity. Now let that sink in a second. But when he said this to me, whoa. And it really kind of put 20th century music into perspective for me. For the trumpet specifically, there's not many works. It's growing, and there are some that are in the normal repertoire circle. And a lot of them are really cool. You know, a lot of them I found there's a piece that I wanted to do that actually commemorates 9/11. It was just a little bit too long to fit the program. So I'm hoping to get to do something like that soon. But like I said earlier, contemporary music requires performers and their instruments to test their capabilities. Extreme ranges of technique, which I mentioned earlier. It can also be highly enduring and draining. A lot of these pieces aren't more than 5 minutes that I play. However, my endurance is completely tested while I was learning these pieces. I found myself, wow, I've only been playing for 2 minutes, and I could do that with, you know, for example, any of the pieces I was working on for my recital, and I could play 20 minutes, no problem. Well, the problem is I had breaks in the piano and somebody to bounce off of. This is just me. Make sense? For me, it's completely monophonic. I'm only capable of producing one note at one time, playing from it. Now, those of you that could like sing while you're playing, that doesn't count. It's amazing, but it doesn't count. We're not here for that. So, composed with a very modernist approach and actually uses tonality and atonality pretty equally amongst his compositions. Some of them blend them, but this one, as I said, it's all atonal. He's written compositions in most genres of classical music, symphonies, operas, piano works. He's even got a couple of film scores, which I thought was pretty cool. I have to find the movie though. And I found a quote by him that I felt important to share with y'all. Music should be about emotions and experiences, time and surroundings. Besides being about music, no matter to what extent these are concealed or stylized, which is pretty true. I mean, a lot of times we get, especially as college students, we get so wrapped up in everything that we're doing, and we forget that we love playing music, and it becomes about the juries, the performances, when really, you know, we love music and we should get back to that. So the piece was composed in 1958 and is actually written for C trumpet or horn and F, so either one of those. It is composed in three distinct sections. And a unique factor of this piece is that there are very few suggested bar lines, common in 20th century music. And there is no indicated time signature except for one measure for 2 seconds. For this, the very first fanfare interjection of this piece is in 3/8, which I thought was cool. And the entire piece seems as if you're floating around, which, if you know the translation of the word entrata, it means introduction. And to me, some parts of this piece, actually, if you ever go to like a big symphony concert and they have music in the lobby, it's really nice mood music, that's sometimes what I equate this, the lyrical sections of this piece to. So see if you can pick that out of it. So, the piece begins slow, which is supposed to draw you in. I'm supposed to play it in a way that you guys kind of go forward in your seats a little bit. It includes soft dynamics and brief periods of silence between statements. Silence is so important in this piece. And that was harder to emulate because, you know, how long do I wait? Is essentially the question, because I don't want it to seem like I'm waiting too much so that I lose you, but I also don't want to be too short, because then the musical ideas don't necessarily make sense, because the contrast is so great with this piece. Then, in the first section, where the 3/8 comes in, it is a brief fanfare interjection that takes place in the middle of highly lyrical playing, which at first doesn't really make sense, but that's what he did, and when done right, it actually is a really nice contrast. The second section of the piece is very exact, stereotypical trumpet, full of fanfares. It utilizes a very aggressive style and is layered with accents and huge dynamic contrast. The perfect fourth interval for the fanfare is almost exclusively used in that particular melodic idea. This section for this piece has the most extreme range of technique, soft yet accented passages that crescendo to become very intense. The third section lays the piece to rest and is a restatement of the beginning theme. It immediately precedes the climax of the piece and eventually fades to nothing. So the climax of the piece is my loudest moment. And right after that, I have to pretend like I wasn't playing as loud as I can to playing almost as soft as I can. All right, so with that, I will play it for you. And I won't do it. But I have to go. I really hope to be able to play some more of his stuff. I really had a good time learning this piece. He makes this piece also deceptively enduring. Looking at it, it's just two pages. It's nothing rhythmically complicated. Sure, it's loud at times, but I found myself feeling more fatigued than I really expected to. Which is why the silence is so important in this piece, aside from the audience perspective. I was stalling a little bit. Don't tell anybody. Fun fact. Alright. The next piece I'm going to play for y'all is Parable for Solo Trumpet. Parable. It's I mean, which I do forget the number at the moment. There are 25 of them. It's by Percy Keddy, and this covers Poco. Now, a little bit about the piece. Percy Keddy is an American composer. He's actually from Philly, which I thought was pretty cool. more so, having to more so focus my focus, if that makes sense. Like, I normally play focused, however, I would catch myself, whoa, that's not what he wants, you're not doing this well enough. And Persichetti is very exact at telling you what he wants, how he wanted you to play something, with the accents, with the dynamics, crescendos, decrescendos, staccatos, everything. It expands the complete range and then some of the instrument. And that's what also makes this piece so difficult, is how tiring it is. This one is not deceptively tiring. This one is, yeah, I know it's tiring, you know? It includes high register notes and soft dynamics, which for me, that is still to this day one of the things I struggle with the most, especially in a mute. It's already hard enough to get intonation right in a mute, but now, you know, playing soft and high, it really humbles you, that piece. The next piece on the program, Soulless, by Stanley Friedman, also on the Seahorn, it covers Serialism, 12th tone. We all love that. That's like the best part of your art project. Okay. As we all know, Schoenberg was the pioneer of this particular aspect of theory, and Serialism essentially is music that uses a fixed series of particular musical elements for the basis of a piece, and it mostly refers to the compositional method versus, you know, what it's actually going to end up sounding like. Obviously that's important too, but, you know, when you got a 12-tone row, you don't necessarily know how all of those pitches are going to sound together, you know? Friedman is a world-renowned trumpet player and composer. He is a graduate of Eastman, and he actually studied with Sam Adler. His works range from solo instrumental to large-scale operas, and he is actually a four-time winner of the International Trumpet Guild Composition Prize. Four-time. Soulless was written during his time at Eastman, and this particular piece was the winner of the ITG competition in 1976. I found a dissertation in which the person who wrote it actually sat down with him and conducted an interview, and he took them through his entire compositional process. Amazing. He actually wrote this to make fun of trumpet players who take things too seriously. People, you know, being at Eastman, you know, one of the great prestigious music conservatories that anybody can go to, so you can probably imagine, you know, people are probably a little serious sometimes there. Which rightfully so, don't get me wrong. But he saw all of this, and I'm going to make fun of it. And he certainly does. I thought it was amazing. This piece is in four movements. If you attended Kira's recital last semester, you will have heard the first and the fourth. I'm going to play the second and the third. Sorry, I'm still laughing. Oh, man. So I'm going to start with the second movement, and it is entitled Furtively. It's in ternary form. Every movement is based on an original drum. The second movement treats it very whimsically. So we're talking about him making fun of people. You can really hear it in this movement. It's very ha-ha. You know, there's a part in which I have to emulate a donkey. It's, yeah. it's fun. It will be in a harmony mute, which actually gives the movement a very sly and sneaky undertone. And there are four extended techniques in this movement. Harmony mute, I also have to do a little bit of hand muting that, which my arm's not very long, so I gotta like push a little bit. Feathered beaming, meaning there's some beaming in there that indicates I have to play faster or slower as I move through that particular measure. Slow to fast or fast to slow, pedal tones and quarter tones, meaning, for example, I have to play an F on an alto
Thank you.
discipline, be disciplined. Well, sometimes the music you can just learn to have fun, and that's the fun in that. And I don't always remember to do that sometimes. Also, I'm hand-handing. My arm's just not long enough. All right. Moving to the next one. This piece is called I Remember by Dana Wilson. I will move to the B-flat from it. We can't talk about 20th century trumpet without talking about jazz. We can't. Jazz has such a profound impact on how we perceive classical music also. Phrasing, ornamentation. We can learn a lot from jazz musicians. And also anybody that says otherwise is also kidding themselves. Because, I mean, come on. Come on. Dana Wilson is another Eastman graduate and is also an American composer. His compositions have been featured pretty much anywhere and everywhere. The list is completely extensive. This piece in particular won first prize of the ITG competition, that's a mouthful, in 1998, and is a reflection of four of the greatest jazz trumpet players of all time: Lewis, Clifford, Miles, and Dizzy. Wow. No. For the sake of time, I'm sorry, I have not prepared the Dizzy portion. But what's actually really cool about this piece is he's actually quoted solos from real recorded solos. For example, you'll hear All the Things You Are and My Funny Valentine, so if you could listen for those a little bit. This piece has actually been a blast to prepare, and I just actually stumbled across it one day, completely by accident, and I'm so glad that I was able to incorporate it. All right. Other 20th century techniques of this piece specifically: falsetto, glissandi, half vows, extended range. A lot of that in there. But I'm going to move to the B flat more.
Thank you.
that was also a hard part for me, just playing this like a straight basketball player. Because I'll admit, I still have problems with that sometimes. This was hands down the most difficult piece on the program to prepare, just for that reason. All right. Last piece on the program. Postcards by Anthony Flock. It is in three movements. There are no bar lines. Anyway. The first and the third movement, you can pick up meter pretty well. The groupings tend to change. It goes from 5 to 7 to 9 pretty, sequentially. Barney's an American composer as well, and he was also a very prominent, well, I say was, he's very old now. So I don't think he does much playing anymore, but he's alive. He's also a trumpet player. His compositions have been performed in over 30 countries. He began writing exclusively for brass, but he eventually opened up and has written works in different genres. He's actually written 3 children's operas, which I thought were cool. One is called How the Trumpet Toots. Okay, I get it. He was a prominent orchestral player. His most notable orchestral gig, he was on the LA Phil staff in Los Angeles. He's even been featured as a soloist in the US, Europe, Australia, and Japan, and he's currently living in Germany. I thought it was cool. I have emailed the composer and the trumpet player from whom this is dedicated to. Blog wrote this for trumpet player Gabriel Cassoni. He's Italian. But I can't find anywhere why he wrote it for him or why it's even called postcard. I feel like it's like a vacation. The first movement is, you know, kind of the hectic of the airport. You know, it's exciting, trying to get where you're going. The second movement is peaceful. We're here on vacation. But the third movement is, you don't want to be back. All the emails, all the mail, you got to pick up your dogs, you got to go back to school, whatever it is you choose to, you know, whatever you choose to picture that in your head, that's on you. But what I actually thought was really cool, just a little bit about Cassoni, he is a renowned historical artist on the trumpet. Now, for those of you that don't necessarily know what that means he does not normally perform on what I would call our modern normal trumpets. He is highly proficient on the natural trumpet, which I think is cool, because that's no joke. He even plays the classical key trumpet, the rotary, and a rotary cornet, I saw on there. At one point, he was actually named the principal trumpet of the English Baroque soloist for the entire cycle of Bach's cantatas and for the second Brandenburg concerto. But again, I know I'm running short on time here, so I'll get through these as quickly as I can. Like I said, 3 movements, great dynamic contrast. part of this piece, of this movement, is the soft dynamics in a mute, from high to low grace notes that you're not trying to make sound accented. That was the hard part for me for this one. Despite the lyrical nature, the piece, it gets very intense. The emotion in it, which I don't know why you're feeling intense on your vacation, but take me to step up. Probably when I was even. It features many passages of chromatic runs that go right into the, so it's very extreme in technique in that way. I think it's like a steady hand compared to the other two. Like I said, we're on vacation, you know? Something everybody is passionate about.